Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Women in Science, Then and Now, by Vivian Gornick, narrated by Madelyn Buzzard.
Contents. Acknowledgments. Foreword by Donna E. Shalala. Introduction. Part 1. Who are these people, and what do they think they're doing? Part 2. Women in Science, Half In, Half Out. Part 3. Women in Science, Demystifying the Profession. Acknowledgements. I wish to thank the Ford Foundation for the financial support it extended me while I was writing this book. I also wish to thank the McDowell Colony and Yaddo for giving me much-needed refuge during this same period of time. I have changed the names of all the scientists I interviewed, as well as their places of work and residence, and their actual disciplines. However, not one scientist described or referred to is a composite figure. Each one is her own separate self. Foreword. When Women in Science, Then and Now was published 25 years ago, it was the first time many women in the academy, especially those in the sciences, heard their own doubts, fears, and frustrations echoed in the voices of the 100 gifted and spirited women whose portraits Vivian Gornick painted. She revealed these pioneering women's rigorous minds, their passion for discovery, and their sometimes overwhelming efforts to balance a productive life with professional survival. Their sacrifices and courage are a legacy that still deeply touches women in science today. As Gornick indicates in this new volume, a generation later, progress for women throughout the academic world is measurably improved. I am grateful that women today don't have to face the grossly unfair stings, like one I did as a graduate student and new teacher when I was told that women in higher education are a bad investment. But other, more subtle forms of inequities linger, and obstacles still exist. Even when women and men are committed to equality, too many people hold implicit and unexamined biases. Prejudices and discrimination often become institutionalized and are not readily apparent unless we know where to look. I had the honor to chair the National Academy's Committee on Maximizing the Potential of Women in Academic Science and Engineering, which produced the 2007 report, Beyond Bias and Barriers, Fulfilling the Potential of Women in Academic Science and Engineering. The report reveals that, although women make up an increasing proportion of science and engineering majors at all institutions, they still face significant barriers. From the moment they are accepted into doctoral programs to the time they are hired into their first professional positions, women have fewer opportunities to pursue their careers in science. Women faculty are paid less, promoted more slowly, and hold fewer leadership positions than men do. Let us be clear. This is not just a women's issue. The false and forced choice between families and careers affects everyone in society, men and women alike. We need a system that, regardless of gender or race, recognizes and rewards excellence and hard work, as well as one that values personal freedom and individual needs. Women should not feel like outsiders or be made to feel at a competitive disadvantage. It will require immediate and expansive action by educational leaders in partnership with the government, professional societies, and science organizations to eliminate gender bias completely. University administrators and faculty leaders must ask themselves, what in our structure and culture creates impediments that prevent women from succeeding at the highest levels of academic science and research? And our leaders in Congress must recognize the imperative of taking action in order to ensure that we, as a nation, do not underuse half of our human talent in this area that is critical to our survival as a world leader. Each one of us must take action to ensure that opportunities continue to expand for women so that we do not squander their talents. As we look back at Vivian Gornick's powerful portraits of 100 uncommon women, and reflect also on the women scientists she has revisited 25 years later for this volume, we find that their stories still resonate today and remain a compelling testament to the rightness and the urgency of our mission. Donna E. Shalala. Introduction. Some 25 years ago, I read Horace Freeland Judson's masterly account of the discovery of the structure of DNA, the eighth day of creation, as the complex discussion of the book moved forward. DNA is the culminating event in the rise of molecular biology. Its discovery encompasses 50 years of science. Something rare in science writing occurred. The scientists themselves came to vivid and curiously unexpected life. A large number of men and one woman seemed to be wrestling with nature, against themselves and against each other, not only for an answer to a scientific problem, but for a prize, a win, a victory whose nature was complex, not simple. I began to feel a network of human beings moving about inside a profession that had a history, was marked by mysterious influences and baffling hierarchies, and characterized by people with peculiar personalities and neurotic behavior traits, as well as by people endowed with nobility of mind and spirit. How each of the people did science, as well as the revelation that each one did it differently, seemed to be of real importance. Apparently, it was not true that all was subsumed in what is rhetorically called the scientific process. Sometimes all was, and then again, sometimes it wasn't. Concomitantly, professional science seemed to stimulate some scientific workers and to paralyze others. It was not a given that if you were a good scientist, you were assured of rising in the scientific world, or even of obtaining a protected niche in which to be productive. There was, clearly, a certain amount of tumult over the matter of professional survival, but the work itself dominated the eighth day of creation, and the extraordinary amount of passionate, single-minded talking, thinking, and writing about science that all these people were doing, even as they went crashing into each other, brooding, competing, confiding, distrusting, endlessly conniving and in conflict with the prejudices of their institutions and with the politics of their profession, struck me forcibly. Two aspects of Judson's pack narrative stayed with me long after I had put the book down. One was the working companionship of Francis Crick and James Watson, the two biologists who solved the problem of the structure of DNA and won the Nobel Prize. The other was the isolation of Rosalind Franklin, the X-ray crystallographer whose observations and photographs contributed crucially to the ultimate discovery. The relationship between Crick and Watson was its own double helix, all attracting opposites and catalytic joinings. These two ate, drank, slept, and breathed DNA. They were welded together in a richness of obsession that had its own striking life, a life that was a function of the work. It would last no longer than the problem did, but while the problem lasted, each of these men felt himself incomparably alive, chained to the other, chained to the problem. I knew, even as I was reading, that this must be as rare a collaboration in science as it was elsewhere, but I also knew that it was paradigmatic. This surely was the meaning of creative force in science. And then there was Rosalind Franklin, of whom Judson very nearly says, if she had had someone to talk to, chances are she would have gotten to DNA first. It was all there in her notes and photographs. She just didn't know what to make of what she had. Rosalind Franklin worked in the same London laboratory of King's College as did Morris Wilkins, who was also working on DNA, and who ultimately shared the Nobel with Crick and Watson at the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge. But Franklin did not work with Wilkins, nor did she work with anyone else in London. Much in Rosalind Franklin's behavior and identity might account for her severe isolation in the London laboratory. She was considered by many, certainly by Wilkins, suspicious, abrasive, defensive. She was also Jewish. She was not a biologist. In no sense was she in the club, anyone's club. But as I read on in the eighth day, the conviction began to grow in me that as a woman, Franklin was something of a permanent freak in their midst, and it was this unalterable fact of her being that fed so disastrously into an alienation that might have been ameliorated had she been a man. As a woman, she was, historically, a stranger in the King's College Laboratory. They had never really had them, never wanted them, never known what to do with them. Women in the lab just didn't seem right. Rosalind Franklin made me begin to think about what it might be like to be a scientist who is a woman. Science is, after all, the pursuit of the real thing, the ultimate effort to separate out what is real from what is not. Everyone working in science swears by the accessibility of that pursuit to all who demonstrate themselves intellectually and emotionally fit to make it. But what if a woman working in science feels it is not accessible to her? What then? What does it mean to work in a world where it is asserted that subjectivities are without power or influence? And yet, such is not the case. What are the clear, as well as the incalculable costs of being one, or one of a few, among the many? What if a woman in science feels she must prove herself many times more often than a man does, that her work is more often challenged and less often supported, that she cannot easily get grants, equipment, promotions, and tenure as easily as her male counterparts do, that she works under the peculiar strain of an excluding hierarchy of working colleagues that is always operative and always denied? What happens to her nerve, her self-confidence, her ability to believe in the evidence of her own intelligence? What is the effect on capacity for creative thought? I set out with only these few sentences in my head to investigate the atmosphere that had generated such questions, to learn something of what it was like to be a woman in science in the United States in the mid-1980s. And as I thought nothing more telling than first-hand testimony, I decided simply to go to scientists who were women and say to them, "What has it been like for you?" I narrowed my definition of scientist down to those who did basic research and accepted as my subjects biologists, chemists, physicists, physiologists, and experimental psychologists. I talked with women in their 20s, 30s, and 40s, as well as women in their 50s, 60s, and 70s. My youngest subject was 24 years old. My oldest, 78. I talked with women who worked in industry and in government research institutes, as well as in the academy. Women who were laboratory scientists at every level, from graduate student to research associate, to principal investigator. I spent time with more than 100 scientists, speaking with them in laboratories, offices, restaurants, living rooms, and on park benches in New York, Washington, Boston, California, New Hampshire, and Illinois. Because of the innumerable clichés generated by sociological analysis, scientists are always the oldest child, the middle child, the youngest child. They have one foreign parent, spent their first 6 years in bed with rheumatic fever, and were raised in the upper class or in the ghetto. I was surprised by the range of background, history, and experience I encountered. I found scientists who came from Park Avenue, Main Street, and Tobacco Road, from the intellectual elite and the petite bourgeoisie, from parents who were evangelists, actors, lawyers, scientists, tailors, ministers, and coal miners, from families where they were neglected, abused, and ignored, as well as loved, prized, and nourished. Every kind of bleakness and every kind of brilliant light had poured down on them. They came straight from the cradle to science. They came by a circuitous route that resembled a Bohemian writer's autobiographical note. What was true for all of them was a shared temperament of mind and spirit that defied analysis as to its origin, but was invariably made substantive in the same way. Each of them had wanted to know how the physical world worked, and each of them had found that discovering how things worked through the exercise of her own mental powers gave her an intensity of pleasure and purpose, a sense of reality that nothing else could match. In each life, a different set of circumstances and a different psychological time span had been required for the woman to put it all together. But when she did, she knew she was a scientist. I think, truth to tell, that I set out simply to document discrimination against women in science. In a profession justly characterized as powerful, authoritarian, and preeminently male, I expected to find their numbers insignificant, their positions uniformly subordinate, their personalities subdued, their minds safely conservative. That expectation did not bear fruit. I was deeply moved by the resourcefulness of women in science, rather than by their victimization, and amazed by the variety of their personalities, their experience, and their activity. I discovered how passionate an enterprise science is, how like artists scientists are, and that hundreds of women who possessed the hunger for it had occupied peripheral, often humiliating positions for 20 and 30 years in order to do science. You could not keep them out of this part of the human enterprise, and because you could not keep them out, they had created a history, left a legacy, had consequences. By now, in the mid-80s, with the invaluable aid of the contemporary women's movement, they had formed a wedge, making the opening for women in science larger than ever before, so that, while the profession was still without anything that resembled parity, innumerable women in science were where they belonged, in possession of grants, professorships, laboratories, and thousands of young women considered it perfectly natural that they should become scientists. I thought I would find most women scientists anti-feminist, as one generally does find the women in a profession whose hierarchy often tyrannizes in the name of rigor of mind, threatening to hurl into the purgatory of professional contempt those fellow workers who hold unorthodox views or entertain perspectives of thought as yet unendorsed by the intellectual heads of state. Instead, I found very few anti-feminists among the scientists, a surprisingly large number of open feminists, an even larger number of fellow travelers, and not one scientist in her 30s or 40s who did not acknowledge the influence of the women's movement on her own working life and on the life of professional science. Generally, when a scientist spoke of the difference the women's movement had made in science, she was speaking in what we might call gross terms. That is, of the increase in grants, tenure, and promotions for women, the alterations in hiring practices, awarding of prizes, inclusion in honor societies. What struck me most forcibly, though, in the year I spent with the scientists, was the subtler way in which feminism and science had begun to flow into each other in these past decades. There were a number of scientists in their 50s who had lived much of their lives as women for whom being a woman is a profession, and then in their maturity had discovered they had scientific talent and had become scientists. One of them expressed it most memorably when she said, All my life, when I've been asked my opinion, I've said, I feel. And so has every other woman I've ever known. And that's all right. We haven't done so badly with, I feel. But I went into science because I wanted to be able to say, I think. When I came to know this scientist better, I discovered that I wanted to be able to say, I think, was a euphemism for, I need to think. Another scientist, a woman of 54, had married at 17, raised 6 children, gone back to school at 40, become a biologist, and was now the principal investigator of a laboratory in an eastern medical school 200 miles from home. Her husband had been proud and sustaining all the way through, agreeable to their meeting one weekend a month in either his city or hers. Then he was transferred to the West Coast, and suddenly their relationship was thrown into question. I think Dave was surprised when I didn't follow him to California, the scientist said, and God, I wanted to. I miss him terribly. She looked down into her lap, then looked up and said, but what would I do with the rest of my life if I gave up science? I can't stop thinking now. It was through such women that I came to perceive the addictive quality of scientific thinking, to see that it feeds something incomparable, a clarity of inner being, which once experienced, cannot be done without. These women, these older scientists who had lived whole other lifetimes as the professional lovers of men and children, they knew the value of intimacy in the dailiness of life. They knew the meaning of doing without love. They did not speak idly or in ignorance, but each of them indicated that now, if forced to choose between family life and science, she would have to choose science. Each of them had become devoted to the experiencing self characterized by work rather than love, and had begun to construct her life around that devotion. Love, necessary love, was now at a proper remove. At the beginning of my time with them, I did not know the meaning of the titles that came with the geneticists and physiologists and biochemists with whom I was speaking. I did not know what it meant to be a postdoc, or a research associate, or a principal investigator. A year later, I understood that if a scientist was a research associate, it meant that she worked on someone else's grant in a lab where the problems were set by someone else, that she had no direct power or authority, and was not a scientist in her own right by the dictates of her profession. This did not tell me whether or not she was a good scientist. It only told me that she was not professionally successful. Conversely, a woman who either had tenure or was on a tenure track line at an established university or research institute and had a grant of her own and was the principal investigator in a laboratory, she set the problems and she paid the salaries, was certainly a successful scientist. But that did not tell me if she was an excellent scientist, much less a brilliant one. I soon discovered it was neither excellence nor success that held my deepest attention. What I found most compelling was the sight of people engaged by what they were doing with an intensity that was clearly transformative. Here was excitement of the highest order, the kind that justified the labors of Sisyphus. And it was here that the matter of being a woman in science became crucial. The question that had been forming at the back of my mind at last focused. It was this. A female person grows up, discovers that by virtue of temperament, inclination, and talent, she is a scientist, and she becomes one. Then what? How much battle must she do to get to the excitement? What is the nature of the battle? And what are the odds that she will make it? Is there flux in the atmosphere? Is she struggling in a static world or a fluid one? In a state of agitation or paralysis? What are the chances of her breaking free and penetrating to the center? Arriving at the center, I began to see this was the true subject of my inquiry. I came within the year to see that this question, not even of arriving, but of traveling toward the center, was intimately bound up with those earlier questions of mine. What if a woman in science feels she must prove herself more often, is more often challenged, less often supported? What happens to her nerve, her self-confidence? What is the effect on her capacity for creative thought? Traveling toward the center was, in fact, what women in science was properly about. I remember the moment the insight clarified for me. It was while reading Robert Merton's Sociology of Science. Merton is a thoughtful and systematic observer of the contemporary practices of science. His style is open, friendly, informed. In an essay called Priorities in Scientific Discovery, part of the larger work, he describes the striking competitiveness among scientists and demonstrates that throughout history, from Galileo to Einstein, men of meek, even pathologically shy temperament and personality have battled each other fiercely over proper recognition for who discovered what. Merton explains, in the institution of science, originality is at a premium. Interest in recognition, therefore, need not be, though it can readily become, simply a desire for self-aggrandizement or an expression of egotism. It is enough that science, with its abiding and often functional emphasis on originality and its assigning of large rewards for originality, makes recognition of priority uppermost. This means that long before we know anything about the distinctive personality of this or that scientist, we know that he will be under pressure to make his contributions to knowledge known to other scientists, and that they, in turn, will be under pressure to acknowledge his rights to his intellectual property. The great frequency of struggles over priority results from the institution of science, which defined originality as a supreme value, and thereby makes recognition of one's originality a major concern. Merton then fleshes out his observation with a series of anecdotes about well and little-known battles among scientists in the matter of original discovery. These anecdotes are richly suffused with a sense of shared urgency, historic context. Women scientists reading Priorities in Scientific Discovery will recognize the territory immediately. They will know these figures planted squarely on the landscape. They will identify with them in the large way that all human beings identify with shared impulses expressed in a familiar idiom. As girl readers identified with the hero in Bildungsroman, although they themselves were never going to leave home. But for the majority of women scientists in the early 80s, Merton's description embodied neither actual experience nor justifiable expectations. His essay was not a record of their personal histories in science or in the culture of their working lives. My scientists, most of them, had long ago put one foot across the border into their world. Many of them had even taken a single giant step inside the territory. And there they remained, frozen in position, watching generation after generation of bright young men move swiftly past them. They knew as much about being half in and half out as does any serious worker who is a woman. But they knew very little of the taste or feel of open competition. That is not where they had been or who they had been. Even today, in 2008, if a woman scientist were to sit down and write a history of scientific competitiveness out of her own experience, I doubt that a work of much depth or originality would emerge. The world looks very different to one who stands on the border advancing only slowly into the interior than it does to one whose feet, from the start, have been planted well inside the territory, moving directly and confidently towards the center. That difference is substantive, and it is worthy of our attention. It is a difference that, of necessity, has hardly been recorded. Addenda, 2008. A quarter of a century has passed since Women in Science was first written. Over these years, I've received mail from women of all ages who have thanked me for the book and told me it was gratifying to see their own experience mirrored in its pages. It is women in their 20s, especially, whose letters have most touched me. They've told me the book helped clarify a puzzling and difficult time for them, the time when they first began to think seriously of doing science and found themselves receiving mixed signals about their welcome into the enterprise. I find myself wanting, more than ever, to put the book into the hands of young women, high school and college students, who have a talent and a drive for science, and who stand in the open doorway, about to put a foot across the threshold into the territory. The modern woman's movement is now, properly speaking, a little more than 200 years old. It dates from the publication of Mary Wollstonecraft's Vindication of the Rights of Woman, written in the wake of the French Revolution. Every 50 years since that time, the movement has raised its head, opened its mouth, made another effort to be seen and heard. Each time around, its partisans have been renamed: New Women, Free Women, Odd Women, Liberated Women. But in fact, it is always the same matter of which they speak. While they had different and specific issues to take up, the right to vote, divorce, own property, their underlying message has been, women need to use their minds more than they need to be mothers and wives. Not instead of, just more than. That is the real issue. And around it there has collected over these two centuries an immense amount of thought and feeling. Women in Science takes its place in this tradition, retraces the struggle, and makes the story of women trying to do science a paradigm of one of the longest revolutions on human record. The second wave of American feminism is now in a period of quietude, even of setback. After nearly 40 years of noisy activity on behalf of women's rights, one half of the country thinks the revolution's been won. The other half thinks what feminists have accomplished amounts to a drop in the bucket. Such an extraordinary division of viewpoint indicates that whatever changes have occurred, they are by no means clear and indisputable. Behind the idea that it is natural for women to do intellectual work lies a struggle that, at this moment, is far from concluded. The stories that women scientists had to tell in the early 80s remain eloquent and illuminating. The context in which they speak still recognizable. Someday, perhaps, their collective tale will be history, rather than make history. But today is not that day. A few years ago, a group of informed professionals undertook to review the situation of women in science as of this moment. The group consisted of 18 university presidents and provosts, deans and chairheads, named professors, policy analysts, and outstanding scientists and engineers, 9 of whom are members of the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine. The committee's report was published by the National Academies Press in the fall of 2007 under the title Beyond Bias and Barriers. And its findings were a shocker. To begin with, the report, a blizzard of graphs, tables, statistics, and testimonials, stated unequivocally that women faculty are paid less, promoted more slowly, receive fewer honors, and hold fewer leadership positions than men. These discrepancies did not appear to be based on productivity or the significance of their work or any other performance measures. Extensive research confirmed that while women have the same ability and drive as men to succeed in science and engineering, with each step up the academic ladder, from high school on through full professorships, their representation in science and engineering drops substantially. The barriers, it seems, limiting their appointment, retention, and advancement remain significant. For the past 30 years, the report went on, women have received just about half of the doctorates granted in the social, behavioral, and life sciences, but only 15% of them hold full professorships. Among life science and engineering PhDs, four times more men than women hold full-time faculty positions. A substantial body of evidence establishes that most scientists and engineers, men and women alike, hold implicit biases that make them less likely to hire a woman than a man, ascribe credit to a woman than to a man for identical accomplishments, give a woman rather than a man the benefit of the doubt. In one survey of 1,000 university faculty members, women were more likely than men to feel that colleagues devalued their research, that they had fewer opportunities to participate in collaborative projects, and that while their male colleagues were accorded a rock-bottom level of automatic respect, they were continually working against the pressure of an equally built-in level of negative appraisal that seemed to apply to the very core of one's being. In 2001, a woman physicist said, "I felt that by having a child, I gave up a lot of respect I had worked very hard to win." Perhaps most significant is the following sentence in the report. "Single women without children appear to be equally likely as all men to complete a science and engineering graduate degree." This finding was amplified by the following observation. "The evidence demonstrates that anyone lacking the work and family support traditionally provided by a wife is at a serious disadvantage in academe." About 90% of the spouses of women in academic science hold full-time jobs. Less than half of the spouses of male faculty work full-time. A majority of male scientists testify that their wives are responsible for 80% of the child-rearing and homemaking that make their working lives possible. Yet institutional rules and practices continue to function on a model of full-time availability for work that still applies only to men. "These are the blind spots," says an Ivy League administrator, "that still go hand in hand with a definition of excellence in science." She's got three kids, runs a lab, teaches and publishes, but she's got 2.3 less publications than the guy in the next lab. And that makes her look less good. Beyond bias and barriers, recommended strongly that these traditional institutional structures and procedures, which work against women, be eliminated. It further acknowledged that to make such changes, a major national task is necessary, one that requires strong leadership and continuous attention, evaluation, and accountability. Until women can feel as much at home in math, science, and engineering as men, our nation will be considerably less than the sum of its parts. If we do not draw on the entire talent pool that is capable of making a contribution to science, the enterprise will inevitably be underperforming its potential. So said the presidents of MIT, Stanford, and Princeton in 2005. This book, then, is a work of impressionistic journalism, reflective of the way I received and interpreted a unique piece of experience. The stubborn, persistent, often anguished, always admirable advance by some people who are women on the educated and passionate effort to describe the physical world from the cell up. An advance that 25 years after it was first described remains. Stubborn, persistent, admirable, and often anguished. With one important caveat, in the mid-80s, the tone of voice in which the women spoke was grave, even sad, often bitter. Today, speaking of discriminations past and present, that collective voice is almost always lively, affectionate, good-humored. Above all, self-confident. Clearly, its future is assured. New York City, January 2008. Part 1. Who are these people, and what do they think they're doing? In the years I wandered among the scientists, my contacts took me overwhelmingly into cell and molecular biology laboratories, where the largest number of women scientists were to be found, to the work of geneticists, immunologists, endocrinologists, to biochemists, psychobiologists, biophysicists, physiobiologists. Whenever I entered one of these labs, I felt excitement in the air. Around the biologists was gathered an intensity of expectation. There in every lab, infecting even the technicians, I felt myself drawn in among an army of workers engaged by an immense piece of knowledge just beyond reach, something whose shape they peered at through the shadows of an ignorance they seemed to feel would lift any minute now. That the dissipation of this ignorance would have great consequence was not in doubt. The atmosphere in the lab spoke. It said, "What we discover here today will immeasurably affect the world that is made tomorrow." It was the excitement of people who believe. I became persuaded that anyone working.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.